Today we discuss something relating to the development of environmental law in India. The study of environmental law is incomplete unless we make a discussion from the past and how the principles of environmental law have evolved through the ages. When we speak about the development of environmental law, naturally it developed during the time of the Mauryas. During the time of Mauryas, the very concept of environmental law was promoted and protected by the rulers. The forests were classified under two heads. One type of forests were called as the forests which are meant to be protected by the concerned state, and the second one which is called as the produce forest, wherein lots of forest resources, when it was during the seasonal times, when it got it evolved, it had to be protected by the concerned state. Now the other one is after the produce forest, it is called as the protected forest. So the produce forest as well as the protected forest are the two types of forest which were entitled to be protected and safeguarded by the ruler. In addition to this, the emperor was empowered to protect the new to create the new forest in the region which were controlled by them. Now most important thing is the Mauryan rulers protected certain species, and these species were protected through enactments made by the then administration. When I speak of the species that were protected, most of them were kokila, then peacocks, then squirrel, then many others, deer, etc., etc., were protected by the government. Now during the time of Ashoka the emperor, an edict was passed, and according to the edict, certain class of species, especially varieties of species like ants, kokila, then the squirrel, tortoise, were protected by the government. Now this is the only one instance which we come to know. Thereafter, when we start the evolution of the protection of environment through the ages, most of you are aware that the trees were protected and the leaves were used for purpose of offering pujas also, naturally, which came under the safeguard of the state as well. Now during the time of the what we call as the interregnum period, that is during the course of the Mughal period, the Mughal dynasty's rule was disrupted by a ruler who is known as Sher Shah Sur, who was one of the Afghan rulers who became the Emperor of India for a short while. Now this person had a great concern for the protection and preservation of the environment. And Sher Shah Sur was the man who had established the Grand Trunk Highway. And when he established the Grand Trunk Highway, which is known to history as a popular highway, which was established in the 1500, naturally provided for the planting of trees on either roads, either side of the road. The planting of trees is on the either side of the road naturally gave shelter to the people during the summer time. That was the concern of environment. Now thereafter we don't find many developments that have taken place during the Mughal period. When we come to the British period, initially the British did not intend to protect the environment in this country. Naturally, when they did not have the interest to protect the environment and protect and preserve the forest resources, they had an inclination to take the forest products. There are instances wherein most of the ships were built through and by the Indian woods. The precious Indian woods like timber and teak were cut off from the major forests in Gujarat, major forests in the state of Kerala. and were taken away to Manchester and to other shipyards in the state of England, and huge ships were built. Now the second instance that is being given is most of the forests, thickly forested areas, rich timber was cut off, and they were taken to England to build the railways. The railway coaches were built through wooden-made chambers, and these were used for purpose of traveling, and hence the entire wood was used by from the state of India for either for establishing the railway coaches or for building the huge ships in the state of England, and the British have made huge money. Now there is one instance which is being given by some of the writers, and this writer naturally leads to the story which has taken place in somewhere in the state of Maharashtra. Ratnagiri was actually known for rich biodiversity and rich forests. The forest of Ratnagiri was actually burnt by the British in celebration of a victory by these the Britishers in a war. They had won a war and they celebrated the victory. In order to celebrate the victory, they burned the entire forest. However, in the year 1864, they thought that there should be a department of forest in this country. And when they wanted to have a department of forest, naturally, remember, the department was set up, and thereafterwards they appointed an Englishman who had got his education in environment and forestry in the state of Germany. And thereafterwards he was appointed as the first Director General of Forest in India. And in the year 1865, the first forest legislation as well was passed by the British government. That is how protection to the species, the environment and forests were given by the British government in this country. Now thereafterwards, the British government during the course of their rule had established or enacted several legislations. One happened to be a legislation which was passed in the year 1853, and this legislation is known as the Shore Nuisance Act. The Shore Nuisance Act, which was enacted by the British government, actually did not permit the nuisance that is being caused, especially in the low water mark area in the upstream of Bombay Harbour. And anybody, if he were to do, and he was penalized and he was extricated, he was removed from such places by the collector of Bombay. Now thereafterwards we come to the another legislation that was passed by the British government, that was in the year 1882. And in the year 1882, the British government passed a legislation relating to protecting the fishery resources in this country. And in order to protect the fisheries resources, they said anybody who were to foul or poison the water resources would be penalized and punished. Then in the year 1887, what we call is they passed another legislation, and legislation which is popularly known as the Easement Act. And under the Easement Act, the upper riparian was not allowed to pollute and release the water to the lower riparian, especially in extreme areas where it naturally it had to be, the lower riparians had to be safeguarded. That was the essence of the legislation which was enacted by the British government in 1887. Thereafterwards we find certain legislation, certain provisions in the Indian Penal Code as well, and the Indian Penal Code of 1860 naturally tried to protect and enforce the environment, wherein it went to the extent of pointing out nobody is supposed to play supposed to foul play in what we call as water reservoirs by causing or putting explosives and polluting the water and harming the environment and other humans. This was punishable under the Indian Penal Code as well. Now along with this, lot of other, they passed the Ports Act. Under the Ports Act, which was enacted by the British government, the waters which are within the ports should remain free, and under no circumstances oil which is oil from a ship which is anchored by the side should not enter the port waters. And if the oil, diesel or crude or petrol, whatever it is, if it were to enter, that was a punishable offense under the Ports Act. This is how the concern for the protection of environment came in during the British year. In the year 1927, they, for the first time, they passed the what we call as the forest legislation to preserve the forest, etc., etc. Now, we come to the independence and the adoption of the new Constitution of India. I just intend to speak to you that under the Constitution of India, there was no provision to protect the environment. And for the promotion and protection of the environment came in only in the year 1976. Although the Constitution came in the year 1950, for 26 years, there was no provision to protect the environment. That is why the concern for the protection of environment from 1947 to 1976 was very weak. This is the only word that can be used. So in the year 1976, the 42nd Amendment was introduced to the Constitution of India. When the Constitution of India introduced the 42nd Amendment, which went to the extent of pointing out that the state shall endeavor to protect and improve the environment and to safeguard the forest and wildlife of the country. So if you read this provision, there is an obligation which was imposed on the state. The state shall endeavor to protect and improve the environment and to safeguard the forest and wildlife of the country. So this obligation came in under Part 4 of the Constitution, which was adopted under the Chapter 4, which is known as Directive Principles of State Policy. Now, in addition to this, the same amendment which was adopted, 42nd Amendment, which was adopted in the year 1976, adopted another provision to Article 51 AG. Now, this a chapter was introduced which is known as Fundamental Duties. Under the Fundamental Duties, an article was introduced, and this article is, as I mentioned to you, 51 AG. This provision pointed out, it is the duty of the government of the day to protect and improve the natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers, wildlife, and to have compassion for living creatures. So this was a fundamental duty, and it almost said the same thing, but then he specifically spoke about rivers, lakes, and then forests. Then have compassion, or to show compassion towards living creatures. So this provision came in, you might be knowing that afterwards several cases came before the Supreme Court and other courts in the state wherein compassion was not shown to innocent animals. At that time they were booked along with this. These provisions were also quoted along with the other provisions of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. Now, when we come to the Supreme Court of India, whether the Supreme Court of India has protected these provisions. Now, this provision, I am speaking to you only between 1976 to 1985, till the passing of the Environment Protection Act, which came to be adopted by the Government of India in the year 1986. Now, there are several cases that came in. Although the cases that came in before the Court of Law, the Supreme Court or the government of the day was not that serious in promoting and protecting the environment in this country. Now, the Environment Protection Act was adopted, and afterwards, after the adoption of the Environment Protection Act in 1986, there were several cases which came before the Supreme Court of India. And what are these cases, and how the Supreme Court actually laid down certain principles which are considered as basic principles of environmental law, which are to be protected by the concerned agencies as well as the concerned persons to whom it's addressed to. Now, one such case happened to be a case which came in 1987. And name of the case is Sachidananda Pandey versus State of West Bengal. In Sachidananda Pandey versus State of West Bengal, the Supreme Court just pointed out the concern for the environment is a great concern. And this concern naturally is done in the interest of the people of this country. So when the question of environment comes in, it is the preservation and the protection of the life of every person in this country. That is the yardstick. Now thereafterwards, in the same year, there came another case which is known as Nellikai Achyutan versus State of Kerala. Nellikai Achyutan versus State of Kerala as well, the same principle, they refined and tried to improve or add some other provisions to Article 21 of the Constitution as well. Then came in the year 1991, Subhash Kumar versus the state of Bihar. Now in this case, the Supreme Court, they said, everyone is entitled to the right to environment. What does it mean? It simply means everyone is entitled to the protection and to be protected by a decent environment. Wholesome life has to be protected. And everyone has a right to get unpolluted air and water. And in such environment, he has to live in. Furthermore, over a period of time, there were several other cases that came before the Supreme Court that actually enlarged what we call as the principles laid down under Article 21 of the Constitution as well. Now the concept of the right to life, which was not utilized by the Constitution makers, was given a real life and enlargement by the Supreme Court of India. Now today when we speak about the right to life means and includes the right to medicine. The right to life means right to food. The right to life simply means right to have what we call as a decent environment. Right to water. All these things are covered under what we call as under the provisions of Article 21 of the Constitution of India. This was not thought of by anybody earlier. Now, some of the cases which came before the Supreme Court of India highlight how the protection of environment has to take place. One such case happened to be a case which came before the state of India happened to be which is called as wherein the question of the state law which was enacted on environment came up. Now, state of Himachal Pradesh versus Ganesh Wood Works Limited. So in this case, the Supreme Court of India, when it directed the parties, pointed out the parties who impose and enforce environmental principles at a lower level are supposed to take into consideration first and foremost 3 to 4 principles. The first principle that is given is the environmental law that is enacted by the state government, which has to be looked into. The second one is the environmental law on the subject which was enacted by the central government. The third one that is being harped upon happened to be the concept of the sustainable development. The resources are always scarce, and the scarce resources must be used to a limited extent, only to the extent which is required to be used, thus far no further. And the fourth one is, there is a duty on every one of us, especially more duty on the enforcing agencies, to see that the resources are preserved for the future generations as well. Now these are the 4 factors which are being spoken by them, and they said this has to be taken as a safeguard. Now another important case came up, which came up from the local courts and reached up to the Supreme Court of India, which is known as B.L. Vadhera versus Union of India. In B.L. Vadhera versus Union of India, the Supreme Court pointed out the enforcing agencies in India, when they enforce environmental laws enacted by the state and the central government, are first and foremost not supposed to take the plea of the government employees or the organizations before the court of law. The first place, generally they say, we don't have adequate number of employees. We are not able to employ adequate number of people to enforce the provisions. That should not be accepted during the course of an argument before the court of law. The second one that is being pointed out, there are instances wherein the enforcing agents of the state or the central government went to the extent of pleading that we don't have adequate funds. The government agencies have not released under the plan period certain funds. These pleas should not be accepted. As far as environmental law is concerned, it should be enforced forthwith. Now, environment, as an American scholar pointed out, is above everything. It is above the government. It is above human rights. This is how they just pointed out in the state of Himachal Pradesh versus Ganesh Woodworks. Now, another case happened to be Damodar versus Hyderabad Municipal Corporation. This was a case, very serious case which came up. What has happened was, the government of the Municipal Corporation of Hyderabad had allocated certain areas in the corporation limit for this, for setting up of certain gardens. Now what has happened was, certain big wigs with the connivance of the state government got it allocated for building certain housing colonies for the income tax department and to the Life Insurance Corporation of India. Now when the allocated land for setting up of gardens were allocated for the setting up of housing colonies, the matter was challenged before the court of law and it landed before the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court pointed out the object for which a statute is established is prima facie important, and the object for which the statute is enacted under no circumstances be allowed to be permitted to be deviated, and hence what was done in this case cannot be accepted, and they dismissed the petition forthwith. This is another important case that has happened, came up before Supreme Court of India. There was another case which came from the state of Karnataka. This is S.B. Muddappa versus the Bangalore Medical Trust. Now in this case what has happened was, the corporation area of Bangalore had allocated certain lands for the establishment of certain beautiful gardens in the city of Garden in Bangalore. Now due to some misuse, the same land which was supposed to be meant for having garden area was allocated for the establishment of a medical trust or a medical college. Now certain public men from the public or public activists, they challenged this, and when they challenged this again, they said the object for which the enactment is passed ultimately should fulfill and realize the very objective. Otherwise, remember, there will be no protection of the environment. This is how in this case as well the Supreme Court protected the environmental principles. Then we go to discuss one or two other important cases that came in. Now one such case happened to be Abhilash Textiles versus Rajkot Municipal Corporation. In Abhilash Textiles versus Rajkot Municipal Corporations, in the municipal corporation area, they had given permission to an industry. It was in a textile industry which has employed more than 25,000 people. And these people were working for over 25 years. And since the textile industry naturally always deals with the color, the waste that is discharged after mixing color with the cotton was discharged in the living area. There were as many as 25,000 people, and the color that was discharged in the vicinity almost has created so much of pollution, as well as it released poisonous gases as well. And it was not for good for the health of the people who are living in the vicinity. In circumstances such as this, the matter was challenged before the court of law. And when the matter was challenged before the court of law, the owners of the mill or the textile industry went to the extent of pointing out, we have a fundamental right under Article 19. And this fundamental right is to hold any profession. We can hold the profession of any choice of ours, and there cannot be any disturbance. Now the Supreme Court went to the extent of pointing out, you may be having a right to profession or of holding a profession under Article 19 of the Constitution, But then, this is not an absolute right. This right is always with a reasonable restriction. You cannot go to the extent of polluting the people who are in the vicinity and afterwards releasing almost gaseous water mixed with the color, which can cause any kind of infection on the inhabitants' people. At that time, there was an argument, they have been living here for 25 years or plus, nothing will happen to them. The Supreme Court rejected this. Everyone has to live in a safe environment. This is a basic fundamental right. Right to life means and includes right to living in a basic environment was the expression that was put in the Supreme Court of India in this case. Now thereafterwards, in the year 1996, in the year 1996, several cases came in. One such case happened to be Kamal Nath versus M.C. Mehta. Now what had happened was, in this case, certain company owned by a person was actually trying to uproot the very stream flow of the water of a river. And if that were to be done, the people who are living would get affected. The people who are living in the vicinity, in the both the sides of the river would get affected. And the Supreme Court pointed out, you cannot divert the flow of water. And ultimately, the state is the trustee of all resources. And since state is the trustee of all resources, water, remember, naturally, comes under the concurrent list, it has to be protected by the government, and nobody is allowed to use such techniques in diverting the water and stop its flow. Now, these are certain cases, and after the Bhopal gas tragedy, that was in 1984, December 2nd, the government of India first passed the Bhopal Act. When once the Bhopal Act was passed, the claim of the people of Bhopal, who have become the victims of the gas tragedy, ultimately became the claim of the state of India. And when once their claim was taken, the state of India wanted to fight the concerned case in the court of New York, wherein the concerned corporation which caused the damage was situated. Now, in circumstances such as this, the Keenan's court, the court was presided by a judge known as Keenan. He went to the extent of pointing out, India is a democratic country, and India has adopted a constitution, and the judges of the Supreme Court have given wonderful decisions, which is being quoted everywhere, even by the Supreme Court of United States, as well as by the other courts in England, Australia, Canada, and other places. And the courts in India will be in a position to settle the matter, and you can just go and file a case in Bhopal itself. The matter came before the courts in Bhopal, and ultimately the High Court of Bhopal gave a verdict and for $370 million, and $1 million, then the matter ultimately was settled by Bhagavati by way of a compromise for $470 million. Now, the Bhopal gas tragedy was the first case wherein the government of India realized that the subject of environment is not restricted only to the protection of environment as well as to the protection of the wildlife as well as forests. It relates to the protection of protection from hazardous substances as well. So with the result, you might be knowing, in the year 1986, the oleum gas came up before the Supreme Court of India, wherein the Supreme Court, in its judgment in 1987, naturally gave the judgment wherein the principle of absolute liability was endorsed by the Supreme Court of India. Now, the principle of absolute liability is, remember, it is based on the polluter's pay principle. The polluter is answerable for what we call as for his guilt. Whatever the type of guilt for polluting the environment, causing damage to the people, causing damage to the species, all of them, remember, has to be paid, and the losers should be in a position to get the compensation. That is what the principle has said by endorsing the principle of absolute liability. Then we come to certain legislations which were introduced in the year 1989. One happened to be a legislation relating to the protection from hazardous waste, then protection from microorganisms and its transfer and its movement. Then we come to the adoption of the biodiversity convention, the legislation in the year 2002. Like this, we have several legislations were adopted by the government. Now, the very purpose of legislation is to protect man and the human environment and the species, the forests, the timber, the wealthy resources, the microorganisms which is found in and around him. Now, the Supreme Court, as I said in the beginning, has played a major role. Now, it has acted in a three-way mode. One is as an educator, it has, in its judgment, it has pointed out that environmental education must be given to all people. And this should be started at the primary education level itself. That is where in the textbooks today we find, especially of the students who are in the lower standards, the environment education is given and imparted to them. That is after the guidance or the directive given by the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court has acted the Supreme Administrator. Now, Supreme Administrator, you might be knowing, in several cases, they have fixed the liability and told them the compensation has to be recovered. Protection of environment is all the more essential to save the people, to save and protect the species in this country. That is why this is called the Super Administrator. Now, the third one is the Supreme Court acted as the educator. There are several instances wherein the judgment it has said, this is how it should be done, that this is how it ought to have been followed. Since it is not followed the way it wanted, it says these guidelines are to be adopted. In a series of cases, it has laid down guidelines as well. And these guidelines, remember, later were incorporated in the legislation or in the amendments that were adopted, you know, that were passed or enacted by the government of India or in state governments as well. Now, when we go further, protection and promotion of environment is very much required. And there are studies which go to the extent of pointing out that the resources are being depleted. And these depleted resources are to be protected. I can give you one important instance. An instance happened to be an instance of 1972. The United Nations Conference on Environment wanted to get a report. And this report, it wanted from almost all the states who are members of the United Nations. And the report was sent with a questionnaire. And the questionnaire was just asking them, how much of forest cover in your state has disappeared? What was the forest cover earlier? How much it has disappeared? How many species of different varieties were living in the country? And how many of them, of the species, have extinguished? And how many of them are living? Like this, they asked a series of questions and they wanted to know the status of environment in 1972. This was before the Stockholm Conference. But at that time, they came to know that the degradation of environment was palpable and it was beyond human imagination. Then they said it has to be protected. And then they decided to convene a conference that took place in 1972. Thank you. Today we just discussed something relating to the development of international environmental law. When we take up this subject, the development of international law, especially environmental law, has developed through the municipal system of states. When I speak about the municipal system of states, states, when they came together and when they carried on their activities, have developed some principles. And these principles generally are accepted by the community of nations over a period of time. One such principle which had its origin and growth in municipal law. And this principle generally is called as the no harm rule. The no harm rule of international law which in Latin terminology is popularly called as the principle of non ludus. This principle, when it originated first in Germany, and later it was accepted by the community of nations, even in the common law systems. So it became a part of the common law principle as well as the civil law principle over a period of time. Now, this principle generally, as pointed out, is called as the no harm rule. The no harm rule contemplates that the states are empowered to do what they want. The states have sovereignty and the sovereign rights. But then when they exercise the sovereignty and their sovereign rights, they are not supposed to harm and damage the interest of other states. This was made applicable to environmental matters as well. Now, for the first time, this principle was endorsed and recognized in a series of cases by the international community itself. Now, states have the sovereignty. And when we speak about the sovereignty, states have sovereign rights. Now, most of the students of international law know much better. The states have the sovereign right to exercise territorial jurisdiction. They have the right to admit and expel aliens. They have the right to exercise criminal jurisdiction over the territory. The right to demand privileges and immunities to their diplomatic envoys. Simultaneously, under international law, they have certain specified duties. One such duty is not to interfere in the internal affairs of another state. The second duty is not to permit its subjects to violate the territorial integrity and sovereignty of another state. Simultaneously, it is the duty of a state not to perform any act of intervention, which is called as the principle of non-intervention, in the territory of another state. Now, these are certain things which are being spoken, and this principle over a period of time has been applied to the principles of environmental law itself. Now, for the first time, a case came up between the state of Canada as well as the state of the United States. And later the matter was referred to arbitration. Let me briefly tell you what exactly the issues that are involved in this case. Now, in this case, the state of Canada had established a factory, and this factory was bordering the state of United States, just 11 kilometers from where the factory is situated. The factory was actually releasing zinc and sulfur dioxide. And zinc, lead and sulfur dioxide, which were released by the factory by way of emission, naturally reaches the borders of the state of Canada, and slowly and steadily it entered the Columbian River Valley and then to the state of Washington. Having entered these poisonous gases and the fumes in the state of Washington, it damaged standing crops. It damaged the forest cover. It damaged the living resources, the fishery resources, the natural habitat, and such other environment-friendly living beings. Now, in such a situation, the state of the United States just puts a question to the state of Canada. Now, we are living in a peace situation and a peace time. And in a peace situation and a peace time, how you can disturb by releasing effluents which are nauseous and poisonous to our territory? The matter was referred to a court of arbitration, and a court of arbitration ultimately went to the extent of pointing out it is the duty of a particular state not to release poisonous and other hazardous substances to the territory of another state and cause damage to the habitat, the timber, the trees, the greenery, and such other subjects related to environment. Now, this principle over a period of time has been applied by the international community at a later stage. Now the second case which came up before the international court happened to be a case which is popularly known as the case which was decided by the International Court of Justice in the year 1949. And the name of the case is Corfu-Chanel case. Now in the Corfu-Chanel case again, the matter was related to a dispute between the state of Albania as well as the state of United Kingdom. The facts, I just intend to make a mention very briefly. The state of United Kingdom had sent 3 or 4 of its warships, and these warships were passing through the Albanian coast. Now, Albanian coast happened to be a recognized international coast which was called the Corfu Channel. And Corfu Channel was an international strait in international law. And in this channel, navigation must be given to ships of all states during peacetime. When these war vessels or warships were passing through Albanian channel, which is called the Corfu Channel, what has happened was the Albanian government made some mischief. They kept some coastal rocket batteries and fired on the ships. As a result, there was some damage. The state of Great Britain did not bother and did not pursue the issue at all. Now this incident has happened on May 15, 1946. 3 months later, there were 4 ships again passing through the international strait, which is called the Corfu Channel. Now, when they were passing through the Corfu Channel, they were struck with the mines. And these mines were actually put by the state of Albania. And the mines which actually struck the vessel, there were loss of life and damage to the vessel. 21 days after this incident, the state of Great Britain had sent the Royal Naval vessels, and these Royal Naval vessels, without the consent of the state of Albania, enter into the Corfu Channel. Having entered into Corfu Channel, which was part of the state of Albania, without its consent, as I said earlier, they swept away or cleaned the mines which were put by the state of Albania. Albania happened to be a very small state. It realized the pulse of the problem and the gravity of the situation then. Immediately, it filed a complaint before the Security Council and indicated that here is a state which is known as the state of Great Britain. Being a member of the Security Council, it is performing acts of sovereignty on the territory of another state, which is absolutely forbidden under Article 2, Paragraph 4 of the Charter of United Nations. The Security Council seized the issue and deliberated upon, but then no compromise was possible, and the matter was referred to the International Court of Justice. And the International Court of Justice delivered its judgment in the year 1949. Now, in the judgment, it pointed out, when a particular pathway is recognized as an international channel or an international strait, navigation to ships of all nations must be given by the coastal or the littoral state. Here is the channel which is known as the Corfu Channel, wherein freedom of navigation to ships of all nations must have been given by the state of Albania. And it is the duty of the state of Albania, if the passage is not free, you should have warned the navigating vessel saying that the passage is not free. The state of Albania has not warned the navigating vessels of the state of United Kingdom saying that the passage is not free. Here, the state of Albania is guilty on the first count. Second thing is, in a channel which is known as the Corfu Channel, or what we call as the international strait, you are supposed to keep the passage free and clean without any disturbance. The state of Albania was not supposed to put and create problems for the navigating vessels. Here is a case wherein the state of Albania had put mines. and obstructed. And consequent to this, there was damage of what we call as the vessels, and damage caused to human beings and the other accompanying goods which were part of the concerned vessel. In circumstances such as this, Albania is guilty of this. Guilty of a rule of international law wherein it ought to have been given freedom of passage, but it denied the freedom of passage. Added to this, it had put mines which struck the British vessels. This was guilty under international law. Now the second major thing, it was said that the state of Great Britain, being a permanent member of the Security Council, is not supposed to violate rules of international law. Here is a case wherein the state of Great Britain perpetrated acts of sovereignty on the territory of another state. Such freedom is not given to anybody. You may be sovereign, but then you don't have the sovereign right to perform acts of sovereignty on the territory of another state. Was the decision, which was supposed to be the Corficheral decision, was well read, and many books were written on this, and many research articles came in. That is why it is supposed to be a major landmark decision by the International Court of Justice in restoring, in upholding, in emphasizing, in endorsing certain basic tenets and principles of international law. Now, thereafterwards, another beautiful came in. I am just putting out the jurisprudence of the World Court and the jurisprudence which was developed by the World Court, how it is being applied by the national courts, which is on a principle of environmental law. Now, the other third case happened to be a case which was decided in the year 1957, and the name of the case is Lake Lennox arbitration. Now, the parties to the disputes were the state of France as well as the state of Spain. Now, the state of France, remember, wanted to obstruct the passage of the river, and it wanted to divert the passage of the river which was flowing from France to Spain. Now, if the diversion of the river and its passage were to take place, it would affect thousands and thousands of people who are residing on the banks of the river on either side. You are also aware, most of the great civilizations actually have developed on the banks of the rivers. It may be Egyptian river Nile, or it may be Indus Valley civilization, or it may be the Euphrates and Tigris civilization. All of them have grown on the river bank. Now, in such a situation, without asking the other concerned bordering states, deviation and diversion of the water flow is a clear violation of the existing rules of international law, was the contention. And the judgment was actually given in favor of the state of Spain, although at a later stage the matter was amicably resolved by the concerned parties to the dispute. Now, the third case happened to be a major case, the third or the fourth, happened to be a major case which came before the International Court of Justice relating to the nuclear weapons explosion. Now, this case came in 1974. Now, what exactly are the issues involved in this case? Now, the state of France wanted to explore underground certain nuclear weapons in the Pacific Sea. And it carried out the explosion of nuclear weapons. Now, what has happened was the radioactive waste, which was the outcome of the nuclear explosion, actually have come out and deposited in the coast of New Zealand, in the coast of Australia as well. In circumstances such as this, the state of New Zealand as well as the state of Australia came before the International Court of Justice and requested the International Court of Justice to give an injunction requested the International Court of Justice to stop almost all the explosion of nuclear weapon activities in the Pacific Sea. In circumstances such as this, they also pleaded, if this is being done, it will affect the global commons. Both Australia and New Zealand contended before the court, we represent here before the court as the representatives of the global commons. We represent the citizens of the state of Australia. We are here only to protect the resources and to see that the present generation of the citizens of the state of Australia, the citizens of New Zealand, as well as other people, live safely in an environment which is totally friendly. Furthermore, they even went to the extent of arguing the explosion of nuclear weapons in the Pacific and the disturbance to the passage has actually caused irreparable harm. And it has violated the freedom of the sea as contemplated in the 1958 Convention on the Law of the Sea as well. And the International Court of Justice, having heard the case, went to the extent of requesting the state of France not to do and not to repeat the explosion of nuclear weapons in the Pacific Ocean. This was one of the developments that has taken place. Again, in the year 1991, the explosion of nuclear weapons in the Pacific by the state of France came up before the International Court of Justice. Now, when this case came before the International Court of Justice, a request was made, or a plea was made, by the state of New Zealand. The state of New Zealand pointed out, before the state of France makes an attempt to explode underground the nuclear weapons, it should make an environment impact assessment. Only after making an environmental impact assessment, the state is permitted to explode such a nuclear weapon, and a report should be given to us as well. Now, the International Court of Justice, remember, washed off its hands and said, we don't have jurisdiction. But then, the most important part of this is three of the judges in the International Court of Justice delivered a dissenting judgment. Now, one judge happened to be Justice Palmer, and the second one happened to be Justice Vikramasinghe, and the third one happened to be a great judge by name Koroma. Now, Justice Palmer pointed out the entire development of international law after the adoption of the Stockholm Declaration in 1972 to 1991 happened to be a consistent adoption of a few rules. And these few rules are adopted by way of a convention. And these conventions are accepted by the community of nations. It is being ratified by more than 150 states by then. And it is nothing but a true rule of customary international law, and this has to be respected and this has to be obeyed by the parties to the disputes, whoever it is. But then the other judge, Vikramasinghe, when he looked into the matter, he pointed out that EIA, in environmental assessment, has become a compulsory rule today. And even in India, you might be knowing, it was adopted after 1992. Now, this decision came in 1991. In 1 year's time, the Supreme Court, in a series of cases, endorsed this, and thereafterwards, the law also effected by the Ministry of Environment and Forest to this effect. Now, he said, in all cases, environmental impact assessment has to be done before a project is carried out. If the project says, no, nothing can be done because it is going to cause enormous harm to the environment and the species and the living species and the resources, that cannot be pursued, it has to be abandoned once and once for all. That was the expression by Justice Vikramasinghe. But there was another judge, as I said, a great judge, Koroma. Justice Koroma actually invoked one principle, and one principle happened to be the principle which is called as Principle 21 of the Stockholm Declaration. Principle 21 of the Stockholm Declaration actually reads thus: states have the sovereign rights to do what they want, but while exercising their rights, they are not supposed to harm and damage the interests, the flora and the fauna of another state. And if they damage it, there will be a strict liability. They are answerable to compensate the loss. He added this principle and went to the extent of urging all states should follow this principle. It is a major principle. It has become a customary law principle, and it has to be accepted. Now, after this judgment, an important judgment came in again on nuclear test cases in the year 1996. Now, in this case, The International Court of Judges, or the judges of International Court, harped upon one thing. Environment is not an abstraction. It actually relates to the species, the living beings, the protection of the flora, the protection of the fauna, the protection of microorganisms, and prevention of the dumping of hazardous waste. Naturally, care has to be given, and care has to be taken by everyone, was the expression. Another more important case came up before the International Court of Justice, happened to be Gabakino case. It's a Gabakino Nagmaros. Now, in this case, the state of Argentina as well as the state of Slovakia were parties. Now, the state of Hungary and as well as the state of Slovakia were parties. Now, the state of Slovakia wanted to construct or build certain hydroelectric projects. And these hydroelectric projects, if it is permitted to be allowed and permitted to be constructed, and if it were to start functioning, it would affect the neighboring states. It would affect the biodiversity of the neighboring states, and hence it should not be allowed to be done. That is why the state of Hungary goes to the court of law, and the International Court of Justice agreed with the viewpoints expressed by Hungary, and they said this should not be allowed. However, the state of Slovakia gave an undertaking that no such thing has happened over a period of time. Now, there are two other cases which I just bring home. Now, one such case happened to be the famous blue tuna case. Now, the blue tuna case was a case which was decided by the Law of the Sea Tribunal. Now, you might be knowing, the Law of the Sanuka Sea Convention was signed in the year 1982. Now, it provides for the establishment of the Law of the Sea Tribunal. Now, the tribunal is situated at Hamburg in Germany. Now, the tribunal is meant for resolving disputes between states, between corporations, in the event of a conflict between them. So, in the blue tuna case, one of the parties happened to be the state of Japan, and other two parties happened to be the state of Australia as well as New Zealand. Now, in this case, the International Court of Justice pointed out, in all cases, the flora and the fauna, the biodiversity, has to be protected by the parties to the disputes. One is optimum conservation, and the second one is optimum utilization should be the yardstick. And only if conservation of the resources are being done, both living and non-living resources are done, the environment will be safe. And in this case, it relates to the living resources, that is the fishery resources. First one is you conserve the resources as much as possible, then thereafterwards utilize the resources to a maximum extent. Both things are very much essential. This is a dispute relating to the blue tuna, wherein there is a dispute between these two states. Now, the last case happened to be a case which was decided by the International Court of Justice in the year 2010. Now, this was popularly known as the pulp mills case. In the pulp mill case, there was a dispute between the state of Uruguay as well as the state of Argentina. Both are Latin American states. River Uruguay is dividing the border between the state of Argentina and Uruguay. Now, the state of Uruguay, straight from the mouth of the river itself, wanted to construct two pulp mills. Now, the state of Argentina contended before the International Court of Justice, if these pulp mills were allowed to be constructed, it would damage. First one is the environment. It would damage the biodiversity. It would not permit the recreation facilities which is being enjoyed by the people of both states. And it would affect the fishery resources. And hence, the construction of these two things should be stopped once and once for all. Now, the International Court of Justice, having heard the argument of both states, agreed with the state of Argentina. See, first and foremost, water is very much essential for drinking. It is very much essential for recreation. It is essential for the maintenance of the biodiversity. And nearby land remember, may be covered by suitable things which is environment friendly, and there cannot be a destruction of this by polluting these resources which are precious. But then the state of Uruguay argued and ultimately accepted the contention of the court and said, we are not going to carry out instances of this type in future. Now, international conventions and international treaties naturally endorse this principle. Now, the decisions of the International Court of Justice clearly prove this point beyond doubt. Now, the second part of the story is whether these principles which I spoke through the decisions are endorsed in international conventions or not. If they are endorsed in international conventions, which are those conventions wherein the principles have been accepted by the community of nations? Now, the first major convention was adopted by the international community happened to be the Stockholm Declaration of 1972. In the Stockholm Declaration, before it was adopted by the World Commission of Environment and Development, the organizers had conducted a series of studies. And when they have conducted a series of studies, they just wanted to know how much, remember, the degradation of the environment has taken place, how much desertification of land has come into existence, how much of deforestation has taken place, the resources, how much it has extinguished, how many species are no more on the face of the earth. Now, these are the studies which were conducted, and then the invitation was given to almost all the states, and 1972, the conference was held at Stockholm, the Swedish capital, and 113 states participated in the conference. The deliberations went on, and after the conclusion of the deliberation, they adopted a declaration. Now, a declaration has a preamble. Along with this preamble, the declaration adopted 26 principles. Now, when I speak about 26 principles, these 26 principles are nothing but future environmental law which are to be emulated and adopted by the respective states who are parties of the United Nations. Now, when I speak of this, you might be knowing the United Nations, when it came to existence, the drafters of the United Nations wanted to speak about the objectives of the United Nations. When they spoke about the United Nations, they said the Charter of the United Nations should have three purposes. The one important thing is to maintenance of international peace and security. Without peace and without security, there cannot be development. But then when you carry on development, there are certain safeguards. Most of the states, remember, earlier when they modernized with the equipments, with science and technology, they just thought that they can go have the certain factories without bothering about the environment. In the initial history of development in all states, remember, it was in development versus environment, or it is environment versus development, because these states which wanted to go, remember, techno-savvy states wanted to introduce development, introduce technology, and environment became the first casualty. But then later all the states realized the pulse of the problem, and they said, remember, it is not good to promote development without taking care of environment. Environment must also be taken into consideration. Both of them should go in hand. And that matter was discussed by the Stockholm Declaration. Now, at the end of the day, remember, the Stockholm Declaration, it speaks of one important article which speaks of a great principle. Now, this article is Article 21 or Principle 21 of the Stockholm Declaration. Now, the Principle 21 of the Stockholm Declaration today is accepted by the Community of Nations as a customary rule of international law. Now, what does it say? The principle says, states have the sovereign rights to carry on what they want. But when they carry on their activities, they are not supposed to cause damage to the environment, damage to the species, and other aspects of the environment of other states, which is a party to the United Nations. Now, this principle, remember, which was recognized in 1972 at a later stage, has been endorsed, accepted and committed in almost all the conventions and resolutions of the United Nations. Now, after 1972, we just intend to go to the other developments that have taken place at the international level. In the year 1974, the United Nations adopted what we call as the Charter of Economic Rights and Duties of States. The Charter of Economic Rights and Duties of States, remember, provides one important article. And this article is generally Article 30. Article 30 of the Charter of Economic Rights and Duties of States of 1974 points out, always states have the freedom. But then this freedom, which is enjoyed, which is conferred on a state because it is sovereign, should not be misutilized by that state. And if this is being done, it will cause damage, and in the event of a damage, the state is answerable to the respective other states as well. This was Article 30 of the Charter of Economic Rights and Duties of States. Then we come to what we call as Principle World Nature Charter for Environment, World Charter for Environment of 1982. World Charter for Environment was adopted in the year 1982, and this is a huge charter. And in this charter, remember, for the first time the international community decided how environment shall be protected, how the flora and the fauna are to be restored, and how it should be preserved. And in the event of a utilization, there should be provision for its growth, its cultivation, its growth, and its preservation as well. The World Charter for Nature of 1982, in one of its articles, Article 20, paragraph D, actually harps on one important principle, that is Principle 21. States, when they carry on, or the planned utilization of their resources when it is done, it should take into consideration the environment of other states as well. Under no circumstances there can be a harm to the territorial integrity, the flora and fauna of other states as well. Now, after 1982, we come to the year 1985. When we come to the year 1985, most important development that took place happened to be the World Commission on Environment and Development had adopted what we call as it conducted a huge study, and thereafter it championed the cause of sustainable development. The concept of sustainable development came in after 1985, and which became a part of the environmental document as well in this country, in India. Now, the concept of sustainable development harped upon one important thing. Remember, you can use the resources. Nobody say that the precious resources are not to be used. But then when you use the resources, it should be used in such a way that the generations which come after us also should be in a position to enjoy these resources. It should be used in a limited way, only to the extent that is being required. When once the resources are depleted, nothing can be done. And it was, remember, championing what we call the sustainable use of the resources. One of the articles, that is Article 10 of the document on sustainable development, harps upon what we call as this principle, that is what we call as the no harm principle as well. Anywhere when you make use of the resources, utilize the resources, conserve the resources, you are not supposed to destroy it and cause harm to the other states. That was the message that was conveyed in the Declaration on Sustainable Development of 1985. Then in the year 1985 itself, the members of the international community adopted the Vienna Convention on the Ozone Layer. And remember, thereafter, in the year 1987, there came what we call as the protocol that was adopted to the Vienna Convention on the Ozone Layer. I just intend to speak to you only the gist of this. Now, this is being done only to the prevention of the release of chlorofluorocarbons. And when we released the chlorofluorocarbons, most of the developing countries went to the extent of pleading that we don't have the technology. And the technology has to be given by the advanced states. When the advanced states give the technology, remember, it should be utilized and used. But then, when you use the technology, when technology that is being given, when you take steps to reduce the release of chlorofluorocarbons, under no circumstances damage or harm should be caused to the environment of other states, was the message that was conveyed in the year 1987. Thereafterwards, the international community adopted what we call as in the year 1986-87 an early notification declaration. Now this actually leads to the state of Georgia, in this erstwhile state of the state of Soviet Russia. Now it had a huge, war vessels and other ships. And after the state of Soviet Russia was bifurcated, these ships were not utilized at all. And these ships, were releasing such gases. And these gases which were released by the ships had, it is called the Chernobyl disaster. After the Chernobyl disaster, released by these vessels, naturally went out of the state of what we call as Soviet Russia, vis-a-vis Georgia, and it reached the portals of the Western European theater. When it reached the Western European theater, most of the European nations who are nearby went to the extent of saying, remember, the air is such dangerous, it has caused pollution. It has caused not only pollution, it has damaged the habitants and the living resources and the waters, flowing waters. In circumstances such as this, the matter was seized by the United Nations and the United Nations General Assembly adopted the notification, convention on early notification. That means, in the event of an environmental damage, it is the duty of the victim state to inform the neighboring states, saying that such and such a thing has happened. And since it has not happened, remember, liability is strict and it is absolute at times, and a concerned state is answerable in international law as per the convention early notifications adopted by this. Now, for example, you take it this way, the incident, the coronavirus which is taking place now, engulfed the entire world. Now, the state of China should have warned as per the early notification convention. It did not tell. It remained silent and later went on blaming the state of United States. Suppose it were to do, the states would have taken precautionary care. Now they would have anticipated and they would have prevented, then they would have attacked how to overcome this issue. And there was no time at all, it did not bother to tell, even to this day it remained silent. And there will be a liability for this as well under international law. Now in the year 1992, what we call as the Rio Summit, 1992 Rio Summit was concluded. The members of the international community, especially under UNEP, wanted to celebrate the 20th year of the Stockholm Declaration. And the 20th year of the Stockholm Declaration was celebrated at Rio. And there were lots of parties, more than 180 states participated in the Rio Declaration. And there, again, they adopted certain principles. And remember, if they have adopted certain principles, what are those principles which were adopted by the international community of nations in the at Rio? Now, I just intend to speak to you one or two principles which are adopted. One is principle two. Principle two of the Rio Declaration, which is very important to us, which is nothing but a verbatim repetition of what we call as principle 21 of the Stockholm Declaration. States have the sovereign right to do what they want. But then when they exercise their sovereign rights, they are not supposed to cause, damage to the environment of other states. Only one word they have added, states planned use of resources. Remember, state planned use of resources to have certain activities should not cause damage to the environment of neighbors, nearby states. That was the message that was conveyed. In addition to this, remember, for example, the public trust doctrine. What we call as they polluted prey principle. All of them, use of technology in preventing or pollution, etc., etc., were part of the Rio Declaration. Then afterwards, after 1991, we have another important convention that was adopted in 1992 itself. This was known as the Convention on Biological Diversity. The Convention on Biological Diversity, which was adopted by the international community, in Article 3, repeats the same provision of Principle 21. States have the right to do what they want, but under no circumstances they can cause damage to the neighboring states because of its activities. This is the message. Now, there are several other conventions over a period of time which are adopted, wherein in the preamble itself they make a reference saying that now you can do what you want, but then you cannot harm the environment of other states. Today it has attained the status of customary rule of international law. Now, I wanted to speak to you one more article, Article 194, paragraph 2 of the Convention of the Law of the Sea. Article 194, paragraph 2 of the Convention of the Law of the Sea points out, now under no circumstances the freedom of the sea shall be disturbed. Now states have, each state which is a party to the member of the 1982 convention have the freedom and the sovereign right to do what they want. But then under no circumstances they have a right to pollute the sea. They have no right to cause the economic zone of another country. Under no circumstances they can cause damage to the what we call as the continental shelf by way of damaging it. This is not allowed. And this is endorsed in the 1982 convention itself. So there is a clear message for almost all states saying that environmental law always is friendly, but then under no circumstances they are not supposed to cause harm to the another state. Now the second thing that comes up here, suppose for a question, a citizen of a state, if he causes damage to the environment of other state, suppose an organization of a state, if he causes damage to the environment of other state, whether he is answerable is the question. Now you might be knowing a citizen is always protected, because when a nationality is given to a particular person, there will be rights and duties on both the state as well as the citizen. Because he is a national, we have to protect him. And because he is a citizen or a national, he owes certain duties. Duty not to harm. And in the event of harming the integrity environment of other states, the state is answerable equally in international law for all the consequences that follows. Or the conduct that is being done by the individual, the state is answerable in international law. That is how it is being spoken at length. Any discussion on this subject is incomplete without making a mention of the United Nations Convention on Climate Change. Now, right from 1996 until 2016, a discussion was taking place, the hazardous effect of climate change and how this could be controlled. And after lengthy discussion of almost 20 years, the United Nations in the year 1916 adopted a convention on climate change. Now, during the course of the discussions that took place, many of the states were in a position to say that this has caused so much of problem. A mere increase of 1.5 degree in the climate, especially during the summer season or during the winter season, is going to cause havoc on earth. And this had to be prevented. And in order to prevent this, people should switch over to the exploitation of energy to some other areas as well. Now the state of India pleaded that they will switch over from fossil fuel energy to what we call as the sun fuel energy. Now lots of money they promised they are going to invest for this purpose in changing the aptitude of conserving the energy. Now during the course of discussion, one more thing came to limelight. that who are these countries who cause maximum pollution. Now many of them said the developing countries actually take the lead. But when the statistics was taken, remember, to the surprise of many, the People's Republic of China was, remember, contributing 28% of the release of energy at the international level. The state of United States was releasing only 16%, and the state of India was only 10%. The state of India was releasing only 6%, and the European Union was only to the tune of 10%. So this was the statistics that was released to the international community. Now, to prevent this, the Convention on Climate Change was adopted, and it is ratified, and it has come into force. And even in this country, you find alternative sources, alternative methods for the use of energy in the near future. It has already come into effect. Now, by going through the discussion, what is that we are going to learn? See, today, 3 or 4 principles of environmental law have become universal. One principle which I have discussed elaborately happened to be the principle of no harm rule. The second one, which is very important, is all the communities, all the states have said, pollution should be prevented from source, come what may. And if this is done, major havoc is eliminated right from source itself. The third one, most important thing, which is applicable to the developing countries, adoption of new technology. Technology, when, remember, it improves, everyone should adapt this in their country, so as pollution is prevented to the maximum. Now, the fourth important principle happened to be public participation in decision making. You must have seen in all environmental matters, before a decision is taken, the public is made, the public is heard, and their viewpoint is also being taken into consideration. Now, the other one is imposing deadlines for the adoption of technology. See, especially when we speak about India, under the motor vehicle rules, the manufacturer himself has to adopt certain technologies before the vehicle is introduced to the public, before use. Now, almost all, your Bharat 2, now it has come up to Bharat 5. And then the other one, Euro 2, again Euro 6, Euro 7, like that. Now, this is being done by the manufacturer himself, so that the problem is not put on the user or the purchaser, so that the environment is kept clean. The other thing, the most important, perhaps the last point, is the agencies which enforce environmental law are to be very strict. And if they don't adhere to the provisions of law under the Water Act or the Air Act, the first sanction is there will be a power cut to the industry. The second sanction is the release of water. They will not allow the release of water. When power and water are not released to the concerned industry, naturally the industry will be shut. Now, these are a few developments that has taken place over a period of time. Now, this is in addition to the principle of absolute liability as well. Thank you.